biggest expense real estate investors face is taxes. That's the biggest expense you face. I've seen real estate investors, really good real estate investors, do really well their first 2 years. But if you can't find strategies on how to keep that money you make, you're out of the game. So it's sometimes it's more important about how to keep money, not make money. So the ones that know how to keep it are doing things like 1031 exchange, you know, all those things. But then they're also using self-directed IRAs because they know that's the game that you can play without running out of the country, that you can really escape taxation.
You're listening to The AZREIA Show. If you're looking for quality real estate investing information that you can trust, you've found it. Stay tuned and join the tens of thousands of members that have already benefited from AZREIA, your home for education, market information, support, and networking opportunities that will advance your real estate investing career.
Hello, welcome to another episode of The AZREIA Show. I'm your host, Marcus Maloney, and we have our executive director and co-host, Mike Del Prete.
Hello, hello.
And his name is Mike Del Prete, not Del Prete. Okay.
It's a long story.
So today we have Nate Hare here, who is the executive director of Directed IRA. He's 10 plus year veteran of IRA. You're a certified IRA
services professional.
There you go.
Nerdy term. I know a lot. I don't know anything else. Yeah.
So tell us, Nate, welcome once again. Introduce us to who you are and, you know, how you got into real estate investing and how you got into IRAs.
Yeah, it's kind of a funny story. We were talking a little off air, and I didn't even know you can do the things you can do in a retirement account that I learned 12 years ago when I got into the industry. But I was in real estate. Out of college, I knew I wanted to be in real estate. I wanted to be a real estate investor. I didn't know what that meant. So I got into, you know, the finance world. I was a residential loan officer for many years, started buying my own property, had 17 rentals at one time. I knew real estate, at least what I thought. It wasn't until 2012 that I was recruited by a company out of Texas that did what was called self-directed IRAs, where you can actually buy real estate or other, you know, non-publicly traded assets in a retirement account. And I thought, wait a minute, are you meaning to tell me that all the stuff that I'm doing with my own money, I can also do those same investments in a retirement account and pay no taxes? And I said, is this really legal? How come I never learned this in school? No one ever taught this to me. None of my friends know about this or actively do it. So in 2012, it was really a mind shift for me. I thought there's more people that need to understand, especially the people that I hang around with, which were mostly real estate investors. They need to know that they have this opportunity available to them, that you can buy other things in a retirement account. You don't just have to buy stocks, bonds, mutual funds, and ETFs. So for the past 12 years now, since 2012, I've been actively teaching, educating as many people as I can that are interested in learning that, yeah, you can buy real estate, you can do all sorts of fun stuff in a retirement plan, and it's really a great way to build generational wealth and get Uncle Sam off your back for your generation and the generation that you pass your assets off to.
Need that.
We all need that. Yeah, they should be teaching this in school, but they don't.
I hear that.
So starting the IRA, right? What do we need to do and how does it happen? Because I know we have quite a few listeners that are young, they're newer to real estate investing, and we do have some seasoned investors as well, but how do we start that IRA?
So an IRA is just an individual retirement account. As long as you've got some earned income, you can set them up at a variety of different places. You can go to Fidelity, you can go to Charles Schwab, you can come to us. The IRA is no different. The only difference is what those two companies will allow you to invest in. So if you want to invest in, you know, things like real estate, do some creative stuff, and you don't need a lot of money to start, by the way, I'll give you some examples of clients I have that started with 10 bucks.
Okay.
But if you want to start one, especially if you're young, I would say everybody start with a Roth IRA. It's the easiest one, especially if you're young. If you've got a lot of time to grow a bucket of money, it's one of the best wealth building tools where you don't have to pay taxes on the gains. So start a Roth IRA, even outside of if you're not investing in real estate, just start one if you're young. But there's other types of IRAs you can set up. There's traditional IRAs if you're self-employed. There's also SEP IRAs and solo 401ks. There's even non-retirement accounts that we have that people can set up, health savings accounts and educational savings accounts. The similarity with all those accounts is those plans aren't taxpayers. So if you can find out a way to grow those accounts, not only do you eliminate Uncle Sam from taking his piece of the pie, but you can set up yourself for generational wealth. You can pay health expenses, current today health expenses for you and your family. and you could put your kids through school or your grandkids through school with completely tax-free dollars based on real estate or whatever the investments that you choose. So easiest thing is if you want to set up an account, you can contact us if you want. We've got a thing to book a call if you go to our website, directdira.com. But just go on the website, look at it, fill out a Roth application if you're young, get one open yesterday.
So there's different accounts, right? So say if I have a Vanguard account or a Fidelity account, I can't do real estate through that account.
Right. And the reason you can't, it's not because the IRS prevents us from doing it. It's because Fidelity and Charles Schwab prevent us from doing it because they don't sell real estate as an investment. They're not bad guys. It's just people have to understand they're an IRA custodian, which means they'll hold the assets, but they're also they're an institution that sells investment product. So they're only going to let you hold what they sell. Commissions on, right?
Right.
So if you say to your Fidelity guy, hey, can I buy a rental property? They're going to say no. Can I make a loan to a real estate investor? They're going to say no.
Funny you say that. Like, I experienced that firsthand. So when my wife became power of attorney, my father-in-law, he had a Fidelity account, literally, and the guy didn't even take the time to understand who we were, what we did, or what our background was. And we're like, what about real estate?
Oh.
You know, just like, no.
Never do
that. You know, it's like, we're just like sitting there like, well, we're doing pretty good.
So, and here's the thing. I mean, again, not picking on anybody or knocking anybody, but they have a financial interest to keep money with them because they make money on the investments that they sell you, or they even make money on float. So when they hear anything that's going to move money out of them, they're like, no, you don't want to do that. But truthfully, some of them, especially if you got a wealth advisor that is not an active real estate investor, he may not even understand what you're trying to do.
Yeah, they might just don't know.
He doesn't know what he doesn't know.
Yeah.
So if you tell him, hey, I heard this guy, Nate, talking on the AZREIA show, and he told me I can buy real estate using my IRA funds, they'll say, oh, wait, put on the brakes. Did you realize how much taxes you're going to pay taking the money out of the IRA to go buy real estate? But that's not what we're doing. We're not taking money out of the IRA as a distribution. We're not creating a taxable event. When you move your IRA to us, that's not a taxable event. That's just an IRA to IRA transfer. And what we do at Directed IRA is no different than Fidelity. They exchange assets of cash for an asset of a stock when you say buy stock.
Right.
We exchange assets of cash for assets of real estate when you tell us to buy real estate. So everything's still in the name of the IRA. Nothing's a distribution to you. And a lot of wealth advisors don't even understand how that concept works.
You could transfer the IRA.
And most of our clients, really, if you talk to really good wealth advisors who really have your best interests at heart, they'll tell you you should have multiple IRAs at different custodians so that you can have some diversification, invest in all sorts of things.
So that's what
a real wealth advisor will tell you.
So I got a question for you then. So you got your Fidelity or Schwab, whatever it is, but yeah, you got some stocks in there, right? And you have money in there, and you also want to do real estate. You want to do work with you guys. Can you how do you transfer or create a new one without having to tax them?
Here's the cool thing. There's no limit on how many IRAs you can have. I have a client with 45 IRAs scattered all over the place, invested in all different things. The only thing you're limited on is how much you can contribute as a total, but there's no limit on how many you have. So most of our clients at Directed, they still have a brokerage account at Fidelity, but they also have a Directed IRA, so they can buy assets that they don't sell. Real estate, invest in syndications, even cryptocurrency, land, tax deeds, even creative real estate strategies work in a Directed IRA, but you don't have to completely shut down your brokerage account.
Got it.
What I tell people is just move enough money to us to do the investment that you need us to hold, but don't move a bunch of money to us and let it sit there uninvested. Leave that extra cash sitting in a money market account or something like that. And they move money back and forth depending on what they need to invest in at that time.
Got it. So I have a job and my employer said I can't do anything with my 401k.
Yeah. That's a common one. So, and that's probably one of the most common questions we get is, hey, I want to start self-directing my retirement, but I still work a W-2 job. I got a 401k with my current employer. The answer to that question is whether you can move that or not is talk to your employer.
Yeah.
That's not a decision for us. It's not even a decision for the IRS. It's really a decision. Does your employer allow to do what's called an in-service rollover? Which usually in-service rollers mean you're still working at the company, but hey, you've worked there for X amount of years, you're above a certain age, you're fully vested. Yeah, we'll let you move some of the money out. But that would be a decision that they have in their plan documents. If you have a former employer 401k, like it's an old job, you've got separation of service from that company, 100% you can move that into an IRA because you're no longer a plan participant of that old company. Even if you rolled it into the new IRA or new 401k with your current company, usually they'll let you roll those funds out because that was from an old company, not a current one.
Okay.
And there's a stat out there with lost 401k. Something like that. If you're out here, you might have an old 401k laying around somewhere from your old job.
You'd be surprised how many people call me and go, you know, they start thinking, and just by having the conversation, they remember an account they had.
That's what I'm saying, right?
And it's kind of wild. I had a guy tell me, I think there's like 30 grand in there. I don't know about you guys, but I know where.
Yeah, I wouldn't have. Yeah.
But here's the funny thing that I've learned about retirement accounts. It's the bucket most people rely on. It's the biggest bucket of people's wealth. More people have money in their retirement account than their bank account. There's $44 trillion in retirement accounts. So it's the largest bucket of American wealth. Yet when you ask people, where is it or what's it invested in? 95% of people have no clue. They're like, oh, I don't know. It's in some mutual fund, I think. What are the companies? Oh, I don't know. You know, where's it at? Oh, I don't know. But it's the biggest bucket of wealth. So if people really focused on growing it, you'd find that people could probably retire earlier. But again, it's just people don't know what their options are. Mm-hmm. They just think they're stuck with this IRA, old 401k, and they can't invest it. But I'm here to tell you, you can invest it. If you're knowledgeable about something else, real estate included,
right?
Invest in what you know best, and you'll probably grow your account better than anybody else will.
So do you all have like a platform, you know, to get started where we can see, all right, what I'm investing in, how much my money is growing and everything like that?
So we do have a platform. So we have, you know, we have a client login. You can see your transactions. You can see your account activity. One thing that we don't really have is we don't have performance-based because we don't sell the investment to our client.
Okay.
So they can track their performance, but their performance isn't dictated by us. It's really dictated by them on the investments that they pick, right? So that's one thing that people need to be aware of, is that you're picking the investment. So a self-directed IRA is really, really good for the entrepreneurial type investor that can go out, find deals. This is why it's ultra important to be a member of AREA, because that's where I found all of my lending deals that I do in my IRA, because it is a more, you got to build a network when you're doing off-market real estate deals and self-directing, because we don't have investments to sell you. You can't pick up the phone and say, hey, Nate, I got some money sitting over there. What should I invest in? I can't sell or endorse any investments to you, but I can direct you to, hey, are you attending your local RIA? Have you been out there? Have you been networking? That's where you're going to find deals for your IRA. And I know I'm preaching to the choir.
Number of people listening might not.
Yeah. So again, important to have a network, important to join your RIA. And if you understand and know and have a little bit more faith in real estate, then why not invest your IRA or 401k into real estate? It's the largest asset class on the planet. It's not going anywhere. It's not an asset that's going to disappear, right? And when you really think about it, this is what's powerful to me, is when you think of real estate, just think of a rental property. You've got multiple streams of income, right? You've got rents, you've got appreciation, you could sell on wraps. There's all sorts of creative things that you can do that you have full control over. Well, when you do those same investments in an IRA, especially like a Roth IRA or Roth 401k, all those income streams can be completely tax-free for life. Now, you got to wait a little while till you see the results, usually 59 and a half. But I'll give you an example. I've got a client that worked, you know, diligently to stack 12 rental properties owned inside of his self-directed Roth IRA. They're not owned by him, the taxpayer. They're not owned by his LLC. They're owned by his self-directed Roth IRA.
Can you explain that?
Yeah.
Can you explain my...
Yeah. So, and again, you don't need hundreds of thousands of dollars to do this. This client bought most of these properties using seller financing. So the IRA is the owner, the Roth IRA is the owner and the buyer. We sign as the buyer, but the client has to tell us what these properties are. When he goes out and he negotiates the terms with the seller, on the buyer line on the contract is not going to read him. It's going to read, for instance, directed trust company, that's us, for the benefit of his name and his IRA. Okay? That's the buyer. We're going to sign on behalf of the buyer. So all the money gets distributed, earnest money, final funding, all comes from the IRA, and then we hold the deed, right? As evidence that the IRA owns a property just like Fidelity owns a stock certificate. Once that property is owned in the Roth, now you can get a property manager in play, but basically all the income comes to the Roth, okay? And if you've got expenses, all the expenses are paid out of the Roth, and we help with that too. So long story short, he owns 12 rental properties now scattered through Texas owned in his Roth IRA. He's above the age of 59 and a half. Since he has a Roth IRA, all of the distributions he takes now from the Roth are never taxed. He's off the grid. The IRS can't touch it. So every month he gets about 12 rental checks from those properties paid to his Roth IRA. He fills out a distribution form, taking about $20,000 out to himself, no taxes. does that every single month. So he's living on about $240,000 of tax-free income. And meanwhile, here's the craziest part. When he gets his account statement at the end of the year, you think his account balance goes up or down. It goes up because he's not touched, the properties have appreciated. Mm-hmm. So I don't know anybody that has a stock portfolio that goes up over time and you're taking $200,000 of distribution. It's never taxed.
So you, can you clarify distribution? So you're saying, mm-hmm. so the rent's coming into the IRA and it's stacking up, right? Expenses, whatever. So then he writes himself a check?
Nope, he just fills out a distribution form to
pay himself.
No, he doesn't pay. He just fills out a distribution form. Goes online, fills out a distribution form, tells us how much he wants.
And he could pay himself, is what you're saying.
He's not paying himself. He's just taking a distribution from the IRA. Yeah, so it's not a payment. It's a distribution. And that's how you. That's where you get your benefit from your IRA is through the distributions that you take from the IRA.
Got it.
Right. So it's just a distribution form. So he fills out a distribution. He can take it or leave it, but he likes to live off of this income because it's generating income. And here's the coolest part about it. When you talk about generational wealth, when he dies, those assets don't just disappear. They just move to his next generation. Maybe it's his kids or his grandkids inside of not a Roth IRA, but an inherited Roth IRA, which lives for another 10 years after he passes. So they get to take tax-free distributions for 10 years, tax-free and penalty-free. So that's really the playbook that I'm fascinated in learning because it's right there in the tax code. Anybody can do it.
So does he hold his IRA and like a trust, and then that trust is then over to the family?
So he can't. So there, you can leave an IRA. You've got beneficiaries to an IRA. You can leave it to people or you can leave it to a trust. Either way, when the end owner is the Roth IRA, IRS can't touch it. There's no inheritance tax. There's no state tax. There's no federal tax. It's completely tax-free. And by the way, I don't want people to get confused because they're like, well, what about money to live on if I'm a real estate investor? I'm not saying you shouldn't buy real estate outside of an IRA. You should be doing that, especially if you're an active real estate investor. But there's some deals that I find that real estate investors, beginning real estate investors, pass on because they're too focused on what pays them today and not focused on what pays them tomorrow. So I told you about the client I had that started with a $70,000 Roth IRA, and he was in his 50s. He knew he had to grow this money to get to retirement. And he's a full-time active real estate investor. So, and an active part of AZREIA. So what he does is he looks for deals that might pay him today, but does those with his own money. Maybe it's a flip. Maybe it's like some short-term, you know, transactional funding or something to another investor. He does those deals outside of an IRA. But all the creative stuff that pay off later, he'll do inside of an IRA and put on the shelf. And that $70,000 he used back in 2012 was to pick up 5 properties subject to existing financing. Homeowners in distress situation, they couldn't pay their mortgage, they lost their job. There was no equity in these properties. So every beginning investor goes, no equity, I don't want that deal, pass. He said, hold on, do the rents in the area cover the mortgage? Because that's all I'm looking for my IRA. If the rents will cover the mortgage, let my Roth take title to the property. My Roth will cover the whatever the past due mortgage payments are. My Roth will invest some cash for keys to get them moving and get them on with their life, and I'll take over the property and rent it owned by my Roth IRA. Put your property manager in play. Property manager collects the rents pay the Roth, Roth pays the mortgage payment. Again, it's not something that he's looking for money today.
Right.
But fast forward in time today, he's got 5 properties that are owned free and clear. Thank you, renters. Owned in a Roth IRA, okay? And those properties are worth about $4 million today. So he took a $70,000 traditional or Roth IRA, turned it into a $4 million Roth IRA on investments people were passing on because they didn't pay him today.
What if you have a rental properties already? Can you move them in there? Does that make sense in any way?
Yeah, so the one thing with IRAs is the IRS doesn't want us to self-deal or trade assets with our own IRA. We got to find new investments. So unfortunately, I can't dump my current investments in there, but anything new going forward, and you could pick and choose. I come to find that sometimes certain investments look better in a IRA because you're looking at the long-term effect of the growth, and other investments look better outside. But it has to be a new investment that you find that's not something that you currently own.
Curious, random question. Can you wholesale your assignment fees into a IRA? You can not take any money?
You can wholesale with the IRA being the buyer on the contract.
And
the IRA can receive a wholesale fee. Now, I'll tell you, I know wholesaling is getting kind of attacked in different states, so be careful with this. But I will tell you, I had a client in Texas actually do this. And this works really well with the accounts that you can receive benefit today, which are not the IRAs, but the other accounts, the health savings account and the ESAs, which are basically alternatives to a 529 plan. It's a way that you can invest a small account and the income received from the account, you can pay for education expenses for your kids from pre-K all the way through college. So long story short, I had a client, real estate investor. He's got four kids in private school. Private school is ridiculously expensive.
Yeah.
How he was paying for in the past was how most people pay for those expenses. He was working, doing deals, paying Uncle Sam to pay education expenses. He said, I want to do this a better way. So basically what he did, he set up an ESA for each of his four kids. You have to have one for each, okay? The max you can put in out of your pocket is $2,000 a year, but you don't have to put $2,000 a year. In this case, he put $125 into each of his kids' Coverdale education savings accounts that he can self-direct. He went out, found a deal that he could wholesale, okay, where the EMD was $500.
Mm-hmm.
So basically set up the accounts, put a total of $500 divided by four accounts, went out, found a property, put the ESAs as the buyers, okay, not him, the ESAs as the buyers. We sign the contract because we're the custodian. We send one wire $500 to the title company. He wholesales that contract to an end investor 8 weeks later, gets a $40,000 wire back, split 10 four ways between those accounts.
Love it.
So it's $10,000 for each account, not taxed because he used all of it to pay for their tuition that year. So he just told us to cut the check. If he did that same investment in his LLC or his IRA, he loses $20,000 to tax.
Yes. So then he was able to take the $10,000 out of each account and pay the school.
Pay an expense he already had to pay anyway. but consume more expenses with the same profit because Uncle Sam can't touch it.
Right. So you keep more of your money.
Right. And those turnaround deals, again, it's like a game. What's that game where you had the, like, as a kid, you put the square in the square peg and the, you know what I mean? And you, it's really about that. You're matching the tax benefit of the account to the investment itself. Like, if it pays today, let me put it in the account that I can use today. If it pays tomorrow, let me put it in the account that pays tomorrow. So it's like there's a playbook for us out there. It's just not taught to us, and I'm just fascinated with the playbook.
That's pretty cool.
Well,
there goes all those.
I'm hardly ever speechless.
Yeah.
And I'm speechless right now.
No, because as active investors, you're always thinking like Robin Thompson, old fix and flip educator.
Oh, yeah.
Used to come through, right? So she would always just preach, hey, open up an IRA, put some of your, while you're flipping houses, if you get a deal that you're not taking down, wholesale it, put the money in your retirement account. But then you're, see, as active investors, you always want to capture that money.
Yeah.
So I never really thought that you could put it in the account and then spend it.
Yeah.
You know, that's very interesting.
Yeah, I love it. Because there's those two accounts, they're called our specialty accounts where you can actually spend it. So if you really understand it, not only can you pay for today's expenses, but retirement. And you would be shocked. I mean, the biggest expense real estate investors face is taxes. That's the biggest expense you face. I've seen real estate investors, really good real estate investors, do really well their first 2 years. But if you can't find strategies on how to keep that money you make, you're out of the game. So sometimes it's more important about how to keep money, not make money. So the ones that know how to keep it, you know, are doing things like 1031 exchange, you know, all those things. But then they're also using self-directed IRAs because they know that's the game that you can play without running out of the country, that you can really escape taxation.
Wow.
It's funny that we talk about this real quick, Mike, because I literally have an IRS bill in my bag that I'm going to pay after I leave today. So I'm like, okay, I'm really listening to this.
Yeah.
I need to stop those from coming.
No, I don't. Trust me, you are not alone. I had a gal, I still remember this conversation. She was running like a coaching program and all of her members were setting up IRAs. And she was just so busy. She was rock and rolling. I couldn't ever get her to set one up. I'm like, you really need to set one up. You're rock and rolling. You're making a ton of money. And it wasn't until around January when she got her 1099, she said, I think I got to set something up with you because I got to pay the IRS $200,000.
Yeah, man.
And here's the thing. It was on just extra deals that she didn't need, right? I got another client. He says, I try to do as many deals personally to where I hit this line. Now, everyone's line is different. That could be, I need $10,000 a month. I need $20,000 a month. I want to do enough deals to where I just hit that line. But if I'm doing every deal, even above that line, I'm just working for the government. They're going to get 40-50% of everything I make. So I want to figure out, where's that line? Where can I get my needs met, pay for the kids? But, you know, go to the movies, do all the fun stuff, take a summer vacation. But when I hit that line, I'm looking at my IRA and go, okay, now it's your turn. Now I'm going to start putting deals in here, because that's how you get tax-free wealth. And that's what, that's the encounter she faced, because she goes, oh man, I didn't even need all that extra money. Now I got to hand it back to Uncle Sam.
So can you break down some of the rules around the IRA? So now we're all hyped up, we're excited, like, yeah. Let's call Nate, and then it's like, all right, but there's a couple things you got to understand.
There are some rules, and these are rules with all IRAs. Your Fidelity guys never have to go over this with you, but the IRS doesn't care much about what we invest in. There actually is very few investment restrictions. They only restrict two things: life insurance contracts and collectibles. Those are the only two things that are off the market when it comes to the investment you buy. They're more strict on who you are investing with, like who's on the other end of the transaction. They don't want certain people on the other end of the transaction because they don't want self-dealing. Mm-hmm. So the people that your IRA cannot do business with would be you, the IRA owner, because you're the fiduciary to the IRA.
Right.
You're supposed to make it grow, and your benefit comes from the distributions. But you can't say, hey, IRA, I got a deal. Can you lend to me? And you make the decision mm-hmm. to both people, right? Conflict of interest. So they don't want self-dealing with the IRA to yourself, to your spouse, to your parents, to your kids or your grandkids, and their spouses. So it's a specific list of family members, right? Spouse, up the line, down the line. The reason why they disqualify those people, like they don't want those people involved in any transactions. Those are the people that usually inherit the IRAs when you die, right? Usually passes to your spouse or it passes to your kids.
Gotcha.
So the interesting thing is it's legal to do an investment where maybe your brother is selling a house and you want your IRA to own that as a rental property. Your IRA can buy a property from your brother. Your IRA can loan money to your brother and it be a valid transaction. But you can't do business with yourself, your spouse, or those other people that I mentioned. And that's really it. As long as you stay out of that, I mean, it's fair game. I mean, it's open game to buy whatever you want. And I will say, being a part of AREA is crucial because, again, it's a team game. I mean, you talk a lot about this, and I'm a firm believer that real estate investing is not a one-man or one-woman show. It's a team game. You need tools in your tool belt. Mm-hmm. And when you're thinking about your IRA, you want to think about having your IRA buy investments from other people. Don't think about how you can get your IRA money out to you. That's the wrong approach. I think when you look to other people to find deals for your IRA, you're also unlocking the other side of IRAs, which I think is important for real estate investors, which is the private financing capability. And that's really where the power is when you're a real estate investor. Let's say it's us three, right? I can't loan money to myself out of my IRA because that's prohibited, but there's nothing preventing me from my IRA being Marcus's lender on one of Marcus's deal, and Marcus's IRA being Mike's lender on one of his deal, and Mike being my lender on one of my deal, because we're not disqualified to one another. And all we really did right there is just create our own private bank. Somebody's putting money in their back pocket as the buyer, and somebody's getting interest payments to their IRA as the lender. So if you start thinking in that terms, now you got the spider web effect, and you're building a community, you're building a network, and that's really how you grow your IRA and have some opportunity to raise some private capital from other people's IRAs to fund more of your personal deals.
So follow up, two points. So I had one member who, you know, what about the people that just don't know? So I remember him and his mom was lending him the money, and obviously it breaks the rules, but he had no clue. There wasn't a purpose.
So right.
It was just like a natural thing, you know? So
right.
What if you're in that position and you're like, oh shoot, I'm breaking the rules.
Yeah. You know? Well, what we do is if we see something that's clearly prohibited in our transaction department, we'll stop it. You know, and sometimes people don't know what they don't know.
Yeah.
We really try to attack that problem on the sales side. When my IRA executives talk to people, we make sure they understand what's prohibited and what's not, you know, what's the valid use of the account. But every once in a while, someone might just open an account online and they sneak by and they're all of a sudden with one of our transactions, people funding an investment, and they go, these last names match. Let's make sure, let's call the client, make sure this isn't somebody that's disqualified to the IRA. So if it's clearly prohibited, we'll stop it. But there is a sense of responsibility when you have a self-directed IRA. You should investigate some of the rules. That's why I put a ton of education online. We talk about it in pretty much every, you know, workshop or webinar we do. Because that is one of the big rules, is just make sure you know who your IRA can invest with. But there's so many other people out there to invest with, you know.
Is there like a fine or like if you got cracked down on?
Yeah. So here's the thing. And this really tells you how powerful IRAs are when you know the penalty for breaking the rules. The penalty is if you do break the rules, if for some reason the IRS catches wind that you did something prohibited, And it happens very few times, but they basically say, okay, you didn't use the IRA as we instructed. Mm-hmm. Here's your entire IRA back, taxes and penalties included. And when they do this, they don't charge you penalties based on the day they found it. They charge you penalties based on the day you did it. So mm-hmm. if this is like 7 years in the future, they say, even if it's like a $100,000 IRA you have, you make a dollar loan to your mom, they can force distribute the entire IRA back 7 years ago. So, but the reason why the penalty is so stiff, and I have a tax lawyer that says this, he's like, if you're doing your taxes, you mess up on your taxes, it's a slap on the wrist and a fine. When you mess up in your IRA, it's you no longer have an IRA anymore because the benefits to the IRA are so great, they don't want people breaking the rules. And that goes to show you the power of it is the penalties are stiff if you break the rules.
Got it.
Yeah.
Well, I had another members. They were not married.
Okay.
Their boyfriend, girlfriend for a long time.
Yeah.
But they would just lend, they weren't getting married till they hit their dream.
Sure.
So they were lending to each other.
Yeah.
Right. But
I would say the closer you are to somebody, the grayer it can
get. Yeah.
Because you can make somebody a disqualified person just by having them as a close associate. I'll give you an example. Yeah. My brother, because I'm not married, I don't have kids, on my beneficiary form, it's my brother. Mm-hmm. So even though brothers aren't on the IRS list, because he's the beneficiary of my account, I make him disqualified. But I'm not trying to lend money to my brother or do any deals like that. Boyfriends, girlfriends, it's a little hairy. And here's the other thing is, this is just a personal opinion. Take it for what it's worth. Sometimes you want to leave close family relatives out of your retirement investments. It just gets hairy. I've seen the relationships start one way and then end another way, and then you've got money out there. I even had, it's kind of a funny scenario, in-laws are not prohibited. So it's, you know, my spouse's parents mm-hmm. are not disqualified to my IRA, which is kind of a weird one. And I had a client that said, I want to buy this rental property in my IRA, but I want to rent it to my in-laws. And I said, okay, that's within the rules, but I'm just going to, you know, forewarn you because I'm just trying to be a friend. If they don't pay, are you going to evict them? Because that's really what you should be acting in the best interest of your IRA, not the best interest of your in-laws. And he said, oh yeah, 100%, I'm evicted. But you do want to think about that. You don't want to do deals with people that you would feel uncomfortable evicting or foreclosing on. But just know the people definitely that are just black and white. You can't do it with those people. Outside of that, close relatives, it might be okay, but maybe think twice when it comes to you.
No, I just like to have those discussions because, you know, as investors, we're always trying to figure things out.
Yeah.
Can I do this? I went through the same scenario with the IRA. We're like, can I do this? Can I do that? Can I, you know, just threw it off.
And like I said, the tax attorney that I'm thinking of in my head, again, he says, you know, well, he says it with the tax code on a personal level and just doing the taxes, if it's in the gray, we play. That's what he said. Mm. In my IRA, I don't play like that because I just know the risk involved. So you want to be just careful that you're using it for long-term growth. It's not invested with people that might be in the gray area. Do those deals outside of your IRA.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. So, okay.
Love it.
So what's the process for, let's just say if you found a deal and you got this money in your IRA, how do you get that money out of your IRA and do the deal?
The first thing I would say is set up an account beforehand. Get the IRA established before you find the deal. Now, the reason you want to do that is every IRA has a special name to it. Even at Fidelity, when your stocks are owned at Fidelity in your IRA, the stock certificate, if they actually sent it to you, it says Fidelity Investments, FBO, your name and account. It's not owned by you. It's owned by your IRA held at Fidelity. When you open an account with us, we're going to give you a similar name. So for instance, it's going to be Directed Trust Company, FBO, Mike Del Prete, IRA. That's the legal buyer. That's who you're going to use on the contract when you buy a property. So make sure you get the account set up so you know the name. The other thing is if you're buying real estate, make sure there's at least enough money to cover the earnest money deposit. You don't have to move hundreds of thousands of dollars and sit there till you find a deal. But I tell people, move $5,000 over so that we have money in the account to cover an earnest money deposit. That way, if you're, you know, wheeling dealing on a weekend, you find a willing seller, you can draft the contract, you can put your IRA as the buyer, and then we can send a wire on Monday or whenever we sign the contract. And then you can move the rest of the money over from Fidelity, usually takes 3 to 5 business days to fund the deal. Another way you can do it, which is something that we do, which is a little bit different than most of the industry standard, but we have a sister company, KKOS Lawyers. KKOS Lawyers sets up hundreds of these a year, maybe thousands, for our active real estate investors who maybe they're willing to deal, and they don't have time to wait for us to send a check or wire on Monday. And they have a lot of accounts that they want to include in a particular transaction. What we'll do, is what they'll do, is set up an LLC. Okay, the LLC can be owned by your IRAs, and you act as the manager of the LLC. So you have access to write checks in the name of the LLC. So ultimately, what you're doing is the LLC is going to own the property. You've got access to the checkbook. You can send wires and write checks, but the LLC is owned by your IRA. Right? It is an added cost, but it adds extreme flexibility for you to go out there and own things in the name of your LLC. It gives you also some privacy that people don't know you've got these accounts over here owned by IRAs. But that's an option for people that are willing and dealing if they want to, you know, get out there and buy properties. But make sure you get the account. Either scenario, get the account open. At least move some money over there so we can at least cover an earnest money check.
What's the minimum that we have to send over in order to open up an account?
We don't have any account minimums. I would just say whatever you're looking to invest in, just make sure you got enough in there to cover that.
What are costs to an IRA?
So our cost is we charge $50 to open an account, mm-hmm. $50 to buy something, $50 to sell something. Those are normal transaction fees. We don't make commissions on the investment, mm-hmm. so it's just a transactional fee-based service. And then we have one annual account fee for your account. Normally, it's $395 per account. Doesn't matter how many assets you have in there, which is very different than other companies out there. Some companies will charge you $300 per investment. We just charge you $395 per account. So it doesn't matter how many investments are in there, but we've got special discounts, some really good discounts for AZREIA members that'll knock that down significantly. So a couple hundred bucks a year.
So if you had this money in that IRA, you need to be out there.
Yeah, or at least get it set up. I find that when people set it up and at least get it and they've got their login, they know it's there, that's when they actually start focusing on it. But if people are like, I'll get to that. Yeah, maybe I'll wait for a deal. And then I come to find they never do it because they never took step one, which is just get the account open, get the money in there. So you know it's there. You know you got something to deal with it. And then when you go out there and you're looking for deals, expand the radar.
Right.
Look for deals that might fit better personally that pay you today. But don't pass on those deals that can pay you tomorrow, because I've seen people take small amounts of money, right, and grow it significantly. I had a guy start with $6,000 in an IRA, buy three warehouses actually, bought three warehouses using seller financing as the leverage, $6,000 investment down payment to the widow that inherited these three warehouses. Let it rent for a little bit. He sold one of the warehouses, was enough to pay off the note to the widow. He's still got two warehouses in his Roth IRA, cash flowing that the warehouses were $200,000 now, kicking off rents, never going to be taxed on that investment again. $6,000 to $200,000 in 16 months. So don't pass on those creative deals that you can escape the taxation. Put them in your IRA.
So if you love what you're hearing from Nate at Directed IRA, but we have a couple things going on. One, you guys are a business associate here. Right. So vetted business associate. I've personally used you guys. You mentioned KKOS with Mark and Matt. I've used them personally.
Me too.
Mark, I mean, they're great. So I'm glad and confident of the service you guys provide here to our AZREIA members. So thank you for being a business associate. But in addition to that, we got some events coming up.
We do.
I know we have one tentatively on the books, which I want to talk to you today for September 14th.
Okay.
Doing like a small training workshop here at the office.
Yeah.
So check AZREIA.org/calendar for more information.
Yeah.
Details coming. But more importantly, you have an event you guys do every year.
Right.
So can you kind of start breaking down? We're going to help you promote that event. So what's going on?
Yeah. So we have two annual events that we do each year. One is our Self-Directed IRA Summit, which just passed, which is like a crash course, everything you need to know about self-directed IRAs. It's the smaller of the two events.
Mm-hmm.
The bigger event is the one that we got coming up, which is our annual Alt Asset Summit.
Mm-hmm.
It's a 2.5-day event. We're going to host it here in Scottsdale in October 24th, 25th. The half day is a golf day on the 26th, if you're an avid golfer. We're going to have it at the Orange Tree Resort. The reason why we put this event on is not specifically to talk just about self-directed IRAs. It's to talk about what are alternative investments that are available right now, and what are people investing in, and what are the strategies people are using. And we bring different speakers from across the country that do different things. We've got people like, if you're Pace Morby's going to be there. He's speaking. Vina Jetty, Amy Majori. We got people talking about long-term, short-term, mid-term rentals. The reason we put this event on is because a lot of our investors, again, they know they can't come to us to find investment opportunities. We can't endorse specific investments, but we can put an event on and provide some education and let people learn about all the different things and let them figure out what they want to invest in. So it's a 2.5-day event. It's a phenomenal event, and we've got a stellar deal for anybody who's an AZREIA member. We've got discounts on VIP tickets, but a huge discount on GA tickets. Mm-hmm. I think it's like a $300 discount we're giving to AZREIA members because we want it to be a local event. We really want it to bring a local feel. We want AZREIA members to feel like they're a part of it. So great for networking especially, and good for education. That's going to be October 24th, 25th. The website's altassetsummit.com. But I think we've got some announcements coming from AZREIA that'll give you some special links you can use for discounted tickets.
Yep, links, coupon codes. I forgot exactly what we have, but we're working on it now behind the scenes. So either our calendar or the website, you'll be able to get that AZREIA discount. And I like it. We're having a booth there as well.
You guys have a booth there.
Yep. The AZREIA staff will be there hanging out. Like you said, and when you go there, if you're new to real estate, you're going to go there. You're going to see all these alternative ways of making money for your IRA or just investing. And then you could tap into AZREIA for your team.
I would even say if you're experienced, it's a great place to come if you're experienced, because you're going to rub elbows with other people that are investors. And if you're even looking for private capital, if you think you know everything about real estate, but you need more money to buy real estate, there's going to be several hundred million dollars in retirement funds, because most of our clients come to these events because they're looking for new investment opportunities. The majority of our clients still work 9-to-5 jobs. They just like the freedom and comfort to invest in things outside of Wall Street. So they come to the investment looking for new opportunities. And if you're in those types of rooms, you can start buying real estate with other people's money.
And the kicker is they're coming from all around the country.
All around the country.
And if you're an Arizona investor and you're wholesaling, flipping, and you're looking to raise money, and Arizona is a great market. It's a solid market. People are confident with our market. So when they're here, they can meet you personally and can build those connections at the event.
Yeah, I will tell you, it is a real thing, and this isn't political in any way, but I have clients that live in New York. I have clients that live in California. Like, they're private lenders. They want a loan on real estate. They don't want to do it in their state.
Right.
So they come to states like Arizona. They come to states like Texas because they're looking for opportunities. Because as a lender, even for me, I feel greater comfort lending in a business-friendly state just because it's my money. I want to be able to take title, control it, right? So, again, no offense to other states, but this is why you want to come to an event like this, because it's, like Mike said, it's people from all over the country looking for what's their next deal for their retirement plan. They want their money off the sidelines, and you might be the one to take it off the sidelines for them.
There you go.
Fence to the other states. We are the best.
I didn't want to say that.
All good, man. So, guys, you know exactly what to do. Go to azrea.org/calendar, you know, to be up to date on all of the events, subgroups, and everything like that. And if you're getting started in real estate and you're not quite sure what area you want to go into, you need to do the entrepreneurial assessment. Go to azrea.org/ESA. That's azrea.org/ESA. We'll love to help you get started on your road to real estate investing.
Yeah, man. So how do we, any last words, and how do we get a hold of you?
Get a hold of you.
No, I'd say we got a landing page on the AZREIA site. So just go to AZREIA. You can find my contact information there. But if you want to go direct to the site and get a little education, it's just directedira.com. If you're still trying to learn, go to our Learn tab. We've got workshops. We've got recorded webinars. We've got all this stuff to just consume knowledge on demand. So either go to the AZREIA site or direct to our site, and you'll find a way to contact me.
All right. Well, thank you so much. We really appreciate it, Nate. A lot of great information here today. Guys, you know what to do. Get out there, take massive action, and we'll see you on the next episode of the AZREIA Show.
Thanks, guys.
Love it. Perfect, man. Thank you.
Great.
Thanks for listening to the AZREIA Show with your hosts, Marcus Maloney and Mike Del Prete. We hope you enjoyed this episode. If you found this information valuable, head over to azrea.org and learn more about our community.